Okay, good day guys, good day to you all. Welcome back to the Formula Sports Channel. Thanks for being here. A gentle reminder to one, smash the like button guys, and also subscribe to the channel as well. These are both free and easy ways to support the channel, and as always, we do appreciate the support. So guys, I want to talk about matters pertaining to two players in this particular video, right? One, Kima Roof, and two, Joey Desert. For starters, we will get into the issue surrounding Kima Roof. Stumbled across this article on the footballinsider.com, right? And the headline reads, injury expert, Roof transfer value could tumble after Van Bronckhorst update at Rangers. Rangers hitman Kima Roof's transfer value could tumble if scouting teams have access to his injury record. And that is the topic surrounding Kima Roof right now. The question has to be asked, is Kima Roof becoming an injury-prone player? Right? It goes on to read, that is the view of injury expert Ben Binary, who runs Premier Injuries site and has a background in medicine and data analysis. Roof missed Wednesday's December the 15th win over St. Johnstone and has been out, or St. Johnson rather, okay, and has been out with an unspecified injury since the beginning of the month. Per the Glasgow Times, last Sunday, the 12th of December, Akoy Giovanni Van Bronckhorst said, we don't know the exact injury or how long he is going to be out. The Jamaican international, 28, recently missed a block of games due to an ankle injury, and he spent three separate spells on the sidelines in 2020-2021. And Dineri claims that Roof's injury history could negatively impact his market value, right? But that's basically the question that we want to ask at this point in time. Is it fair to say that Kima Roof is becoming an injury-prone player? Guys, in the last four seasons, Kima Roof has spent a substantial amount of time on the sidelines because of various injuries in the last four seasons. We're talking about calf injury, we're talking about thigh injury, we're talking about an ankle injury. This particular injury that Roof has right now is unspecified, and the article also, you know, spoke to that in terms of that could be, it could be or it could not be problematic, right? From the standpoint of Rangers is not even specifying what the injury is. So the article was just saying that that could be problematic. The article did also state that it doesn't necessarily have to be a big deal, right? But is Kima Roof becoming an injury-prone player, right? Multiple injuries plaguing this player. Here's the thing, guys. I wouldn't be quick to label a player as being injury-prone if he has one single issue that keeps on arising, right? If that one single issue, you know, keeps on ruling him out over a significant amount of time, then, you know, you could probably attach that label of being injury prone to the player. But the thing with Kima Roof is not one particular injury, is multiple injuries. Is it fair to say that the player is injury prone? Because I think that if you have multiple injuries that are constantly plaguing you, right, multiple types of injuries, then I think it is fair. You know, I wouldn't argue against anybody who attaches that label to Kima Roof of being injury prone, right? I don't know what Kima Roof needs to do to curb this, right? Does he need to, you know, go about having a diet change? Does he need a lifestyle change? Like what Mikel Antonio said that he did, right? I don't know what he needs to do to curb this, but he needs to do something quick and fast, guys, because it is never a good thing to have the injury tag being attached to you, the injury label being attached to you. It is never a good thing. For starters, it could affect your ability to have a long career. That is the first thing. Second of all, it could deny you opportunities down the road, right? Opportunities, I don't know, to play in big games, right? Or even transfer opportunities. Let's say a bigger club is interested in the player. When they look at the player's injury record, right, they might be turned off. Those are issues that Kemar Roofe needs to realize could affect him because of this injury tag that is now being ascribed to him, right? We have also seen where it has affected the player's ability to play for his country. He missed the United States of America game because of this unspecified injury. So we also see that it is not, you know, his recent injury history is not only affecting Rangers, but it is also affecting Jamaica. And for us, Jamaica, Kemar Roofe is a massive player. For us, we would want him to be available at all times. The player is arguably the most clinical striker the Reggae Boys has at our disposal. And also, he is a very versatile player who can play anywhere in the front three, right? So whatever Kemar Roofe needs to do to try and curb these issues that are arising, hire an expert, you know, to try and curb these issues. You know, I don't know, but he needs to do something quick and fast. Hire an expert in the respective field to go about ensuring that he stays on the, he's, you know, on the pitch more often than he is, you know, or, you know, do a lifestyle change or whatever the player needs to do. You know, so far this season, the player has played 13 games in the Premiership, scored 6 goals, 15 games in the Europa League, scored 1 goal, and 2 games in the Scottish Cup, scored 3 goals, 10 goals in all competitions in 20 games. It's just a pity that we haven't seen more of the player so far this season, but when we have seen the player, he has been having a good season. Up next, want to talk a little bit about this particular player that I've been advocating for to get a fair chance in our national team, right? A player by the name of Joey Desart, a central defensive midfielder who can also play as a number 8. Guys, I think it's unfair what has happened to this player, right? Nobody can tell me that this particular player is not better than some of the CDMs that we have used so far in the World Cup qualifying campaign. Right? The player, in my humble opinion, needs to be given a chance to prove himself. He needs to be called up for the upcoming Peru friendly. Right? Joey Desart has made 17 appearances so far this season in the MLS. I've watched a number of those games. The player started out when he initially was making substitute appearances. And then because of the injury to Mendes, you know, he basically became was thrusted into the starting lineup. Had a rocky start to some extent, but then eventually got up to speed and started doing very well. I personally think that the player needs to get a move quick and fast, because in my humble opinion, he's a starting MLS quality central defensive midfielder. The issue at hand though is that, you know, when he went to Orlando City, he went there seeing 2 very good pivot players for Orlando City, right? In Urso and Mendes. Those players, you know, Mendes is a very good CDM, Urso is a very good number 8, and he's basically the heart and soul of Orlando City. So the player needs to get a move because it is going to be very difficult, despite how good he is, it's going to be very difficult for him to get in ahead of those 2 players, right? The number 6 and the number 8 at Orlando City, right? But as I said, guys, he is a starting MLS quality CDM, no doubt about it. Right, and you see, players like this, we need to cap them. We need to cap a Joey Desart. From my understanding of it, The player is also eligible to play for the United States. Players who are eligible to play for our CONCACAF rivals, as well as us, we need to cap them. Look at the you know, one of the three goalkeepers that was in the US squad that faced us in the last World Cup qualifier, right? I think he plays at New York City. He is a former Jamaica youth national, like Joey Desart, right? He would be very good, at the very least, very good depth for us in the goalkeeping department if we had kept him earlier on. Now he's representing and bolstering a CONCACAF rival. There is no telling how good Joey Desart will become. He is a young player, right? He could very much blossom into a very good player, make the United States team, and make them better and improve them, right? Added to the fact that we need the player right now, we need to cap this player, right? I want to talk a little bit about the attributes of Joey Desart, right? Very good with the ball at his feet, both in terms of his ball control, his touch, and also when he is moving with the football. He's a very good ball carrier, and he has good touch on the dribble, right? He's very good with the ball at his feet. He is very good in tight spaces when being pressed, right? He is what you call a press-resistant, deeper-line midfielder, right? Very skillful as well, right? And he's skillful when he needs to be. So whenever he's in a spot of bother, right, in a tight area, so to speak, he possesses the ability to, you know, pull out a trick out the bag and get himself out of hot water. He plays simple but effective. He does what he needs to do, right? He doesn't try to be flashy. He does what he needs to do, keeps it simple, and this is very much effective for Orlando City. He can play as a number six or a number eight. He can play as a six to shield the back line. He can play as an eight in terms of going forward and helping his team on the attacking side of things, being a good box-to-box midfielder. I've seen him play as a number eight for Orlando. The player looked comfortable, guys. Trust me, very comfortable. The player has good aerial ability, right? He is tall and he is also very athletic. So he can, you know, he has a good jump on him. So he's very good in the air. Excellent passing accuracy and good range in passing. The stats says he is good with passing. The eye test says he is good with passing. Very good passer of the football. He is very mobile. He's a quick player. He is very mobile. Whether you need mobility for him to be a passing option, for him to be an outballer, for him to recycle the play, he is very, very mobile. Something that our deeper line midfielders, especially the CDMs in the World Cup qualification, has struggled to do. You know, struggled where mobility is concerned. Our players, Jamaican CDMs, have struggled where mobility is concerned. He is disciplined as a number six, right? He will sit and try to protect the back line. He's not indisciplined where that is concerned. And also, he is a good tackler in 1v1 scenarios, right? As I mentioned, the player did not start the season as a starter. He was thrusted into the starting lineup because of injury. Initially, when he started, and this is the downside, initially when he started to start, he was guilty of lazy tracking and bad positional play that even led to some goals being conceded on the part of Orlando City, right? But the player eventually started to get up to speed and started to improve where that is concerned. I will say this one thing about him. When it comes to being excellent at positional play and clogging the passing lanes, he's not a bad player, but Anthony Grant is certainly a better player than him where that is concerned, in terms of clogging the passing lanes and being pinpoint where his positional play is. Not that Joey Desert is a bad player doing that, but, you know, Anthony Grant is top-notch where that is concerned. So, you know, I believe that this player, Joey Desert, is better than a number of the CDMs that we have used in this World Cup qualification campaign. He needs to be called up for the Peru game, needs to be given his fair shot at representing his country, you know, a former national youth representative. Guys, remember to smash the like button, subscribe to the channel as well. Take care, stay safe, and until next time.